I'm going to give you a review of ultra-realistic 3D imaging. That is, of course, the only technique that exists here in the world is holography that can provide it. And fortunately now, we have been able to make it. So this is really a turn for really that holography will be probably becoming popular, as you will see from the other speakers as well. And this has been the missing link. We need extremely realistic images, and we of course need all the colors of the object if we talk about archival applications like for museums and so. So let me now what we mean, of course, with ultra-realistic image, first of all, resolution is absolutely perfect. All the reflection moves as if they were there emitted from the real object when you look at it. You also hopefully want 180 field of view, both horizontally or vertically, which means that the Denisyuk technique is really the best for analog museum holograms, as long as the objects are within the size of the plates that you can have. And of course, ultra-realistic imaging also is, of course, scale 1:1. So otherwise, if you play with a reduction or so, you are no longer exactly ultra-realistic. On the other hand, there are techniques where we can, with the digital, which you will also know about, where you now have come so far that even they can be extremely high quality. And of course, they will also have color. So I will talk about recording techniques and materials, applications of analog and digital color holograms. The progress of color holography has depended on four main things: the recording laser wavelengths, the recording setup, the recording material, and not least, the light source used to illuminate the recorded hologram. Even there, we have a revolution now going on, going back away from halogen to LED light, which has tremendous advantage, in particular for ultra-realistic imaging, as you will see. I have published this before. You may be familiar what wavelengths to use to make good color holograms and how many you need. This thing is actually based on the Macbeth targets, and the error is the average sum of all these patches. So when you go through, some of them may be not as good, some will be better, but overall, all of them will have a decreased value of the error between recording it with white light. So, and these are the wavelengths that one should think of trying. Of course, none of us really are using them, not even me. So my three colors are not the optimum, which I would love. The problem is to find the lasers that have these wavelengths. So, but anyhow, and also this wavelength problem has nothing to do really with holography. It's a question of when you illuminate this target with lasers, how many lasers do you need and how many wavelengths and which wavelength to your eye to see this as if it was lit with white light. The holographic material doesn't come in. We only assume we have absolutely perfect material, and material can only make it worse. It can never improve it. So you need to have ultra fine grain materials to avoid scattering. The materials we work with in panchromatic is silver halide and photopolymer. There are also, of course, dichromated gelatin, full color or panchromatic material. They are rather difficult. Only a few are able to do it. So it's not really for people who would like to get started. They have to select silver halide or photopolymer unless you are an expert on dichromated gelatin. When we come to panchromatic silver halide materials, there are not that many in the world that make them. So the main producers are color holographic in England. Slavish has been for a long time, but now they still do them, but the highest quality is produced by Sfera S, which is the director of this company was involved in production here. He left set up a new company, and they are producing the best Russian plates. And then, of course, we have Yves Chantier in France, Ultimate, and he, of course, he now told me that they will be accessible to people who want to buy. There were some limitations before, so you should be able to get them. When we get to polymer, you have these two main players with panchromatic material. DuPont, of course, have been around for a long time, and Zebra, others are actually using them to produce color hologram. Bayer is a new player, and they also have an excellent product that we don't know if they will be restricted to art or display holographer. There is some rumors that also they want just to see them used for security holograms. And nevertheless, there is an example of a photopolymer hologram there. And here you can see some of the properties of this material. They have, of course, panchromatic. They can get high diffraction efficiency. And most important, they have almost no shrinkage. So for color holography, they are perfect. Because otherwise it will affect the color reproduction. And they have a fairly good delta N. Now we come to analog color holograms, the type of things I have been working on for a long time. So here is a three laser setup to make Dennis Yoke holograms. So we combine red, green, and blue laser with beam combiners. Let them go through the same spatial filter and illuminate the plate, the object behind the plate there. And so, and this is how the holograms you see here that I have been recorded. And since I have set up several holographic color labs, I always use this principle that you have the lasers in one room, completely shielded from the recording, so all the noise, acoustic noise, and power supplies, water cooling, are not heard in the recording room. The laser beam, the white one, go through a hole in the wall, and on the other side you have the recording table, and there you can't hear anything, so you can have long exposures without being worried about any acoustical noise. Now, something else has happened. There has been one of the problems with holography is if you talk about museum objects, that they have to be brought to a lab. And all museums hate to remove anything and bring it on the road somewhere, or even thinking of putting it in an airplane or some. So if we can bring the equipment to them, that is more important to get it more spread. And thanks to the people in Greece, we will hear a presentation by them, so I'm not going into any details. After my paper, I'm sure they will talk more, but they have a portable system with a red, green, blue laser, as you can see here, and they can now bring that to museum. So this is a prototype, and that hologram actually you saw yesterday in the exhibition is produced with that camera. They can do up to 30 by 40 centimeter plates with this camera. And they also have a mobile darkroom that you bring to the museum. So, because you, of course, to check that everything works, you need to process the plates at the museum and see that you have got what you need before you leave. And then there is also a camera we will hear about later today from India that I didn't know about, as also Chantier and Seltsov have made a mobile camera as well, which is a reference to in my paper. Now we come to the other thing that has a very big impact, in particular on color hologram, is how do you illuminate them to display them. And now we are very happy that we have got LED. So in particular for a color hologram, it's much more important to have the right type of spotlight than it is for a monochrome, of course. And one important thing is the loss there, that the angle of the light hitting the plate has to be the same as you had when you recorded it. If you tilt it in that way, the hologram gets the wrong color. If you go that way, they get the wrong color. Only at this you have the correct color reproduction. All of us have used these type of lights for years now to illuminate hologram, halogen lights, with this type of spectrum, where you have primarily most in the red part of the spectrum. They work okay, of course, and have been, but they are not the best for color holograms. So what can the new LED offer us? They have smaller bandwidth, which is very, very good for color holograms. They hopefully we would like to match them to the recording wavelengths. That is sometimes a mismatch because not all wavelengths in LEDs are the same as the wavelengths you have in lasers, but you try to work on that. And then that means that when you illuminate the hologram, only the light that generates the image is coming out. All the light in between that we have in the continuous spectrum is scattered off the glass plate or the emulsion and produce extra noise. So, and an LED is typical how it is made. So you have a very, very narrow source size here, which is also important, as you can see. Here are the advantages of them. Long life, small size, small attendue, high durability, low energy usage, so it's environmentally friendly. No infrared or UV, which is very important because a lot of the UV normally destroy holograms. And then you have directional output you can get. And this is very important also for the LED. The prototype that, or the light that they do in Greece, you can control individually RGB. So if your color hologram is not perfect when you recorded it, if it's a little too red, you can reduce the red in the LED and add a little more of green. So it's sort of playing with the colors at the reconstruction stage, which is another advantage which you can't do with a halogen light. And so that's why the preferred LED red is the red based on RGB. So RGB LEDs should be used, not the one that has a fluorescence to create white, because they are not good for color. So you need to go with this. That's what they have in the prototype from Greece. And also there's our typical bandwidth of these light sources. Here is one, of course, you can see it in reality there, and I'm sure they will talk more about it in their presentation. Here I did an experiment. This is another hologram that was recorded on a Slavish plate that is slightly noisy. And this is, so you can see if you go with the halogen light to the LED, how you just can improve the quality of your hologram by selecting LED light instead of halogen light. So what that there you have an improvement. Now let me tell you what is happening in around the world. These are the companies that are and I am familiar with and are active around the world. Color Holographic, Dai Nippon doing photopolymer in Japan. Yola, of course, is a big player. Hellenic Institute of Holography has become now a main player in the field. You will hear about it in the next talk. Holorad in Utah has also started to record color. And I believe that Stephen Hart will be here on Friday talk about that. Lite Holographics, represented here, has also started now to do things partly with Yola, but also on their own. Strasbourg University has been there. I mean, at one of the first labs I set up together with Dali Borbakicevic when I was there, and it's still able to have an excellent color holographic lab. And then we have Ultimate, of course, that is Yves Chantier's extremely good quality holograms that he can make. And of course, Zebra here in the United States have been around for a long time and is a main leader in the field. Then we have companies that are actually using the service from people like Yola. And these are the companies that currently are involved getting service or printing the holograms by Yola. And these are the ones I know he's working with. But there is also individual artists now that can submit data or work to send to him and have them printed. So anybody who can generate 3D computer graphics can have them printed. or if you get one of these systems where you can record a stereogram. Let's now talk about art reproduction and what I believe is extremely important in the future. It is that we can now have exhibitions with a collection of the best in the world can be arranged anywhere in the world without any expensive shipping and insurance cost. Another important thing that if you want to show the entire Leonardo da Vinci work in one single museum where they are spread around the world, you just put them together at holograms. And this, of course, includes oil paintings as well. We heard about it yesterday, and I'm sure we can solve it and get them absolutely perfect, but we need more than three wavelengths there, because there the color reproduction is the main thing. And then, of course, the 3D is less important, although the structure or the texture of the painting is very important. It could be also a very good thing for the insurance company with expensive paintings that they request a holographic reproduction of it so they can look at the details of the painting, or if it should be stolen they can identify it's exactly the same as well. If it's damaged they can use a holographic copy to look at how to repair it. And of course in art education is also what I believe that each art school around the world could provide the students with the best collection around the world of the art pieces in their institutes. Okay, now we will talk. I have been working with the British Museum for one project I will talk about. And this is very important because British Museum is, of course, one of the main worldwide museums. And they have almost always rejected holography, although they did the Lindau man with Edwina Orr and so, but of course it was monochrome and it was on display, it's no longer on display. So they have been a little involved, but most museums have always been very disappointed with holography. Often they say they don't even want to hear the word. But now, if you read what she said, this is after what can be done today for them, and they have actually got involved now. So she is extremely positive to using holography again. And another player here that has started for museum work is Color Holographic. As you know, he makes excellent material based on Bärenheide's BB planes. He has now got even panchromatic emulsion with much higher quality than he had a few years ago. And he has started to recording artifacts for museum. It was for exhibition in Birmingham, for example. And I have an example here of Princess Nistan Basu here from around 1000 BC, which he recorded the front and back of this, and they display it like that. This, of course, you couldn't do without holography. So now you can actually take advantage of that. You can do these things for museum displays. So this is a nice work from Color Holographic. And then we have the people in Greece, you will hear about it. But Color Holographic has also made this type of device, little wooden box for 8x10 color holograms. And they, on the lid here, they have put an LED light. So when you open it up, the light is correct to illuminate in the box. You can actually replace these holograms with different color holograms for display. And here is an example of one such a hologram recorded on the BB Pan emulsion from their own in-house production. And then, now I talk about what I did when I was still at the Modern Optics. So here we have the Center for Modern Optics. You saw the lab with the lasers and so there. We had this virtual artifact traveling exhibition. So we started to make something of 10 different objects that will go tour around in Wales and nearby museums that they could never show without it. So if we look at what we did, this is one of them. That is the horse yaw from the Ice Age. It's like a little necklace that you put around your neck, and it has a beautiful pattern engraved on this horse yaw. This is how they are recorded with the hologram, with an overhead beam, 45 degree coming down with the white laser light. Put the object underneath there and the plate above it and record it. And this is a hologram. And this is another, the Tudor oil jug, which is from 16th century, came from the Grossman Museum in Chester, Grosvenor Museum in Westner. And this is a beautiful little Tudor oil jug. And this is how it was set up in the lab. And here is a final hologram. So it's, there is the ring on a mount. Here is the hologram of it. And we can also go in and take a closer look at the head of the old jug, which is very beautiful, as you can see. So this is really what they got very excited about. Then we arranged this traveling exhibition. So here are the hologram in Llangollen Museum in Wales. And I'm just going to show you, because my time is coming down and the chairman is reminding me I have to stop. So here is, from this exhibition, there is a horseshoe in the, and there is, this I wanted to mention about, because this, since that iron axe was actually from that museum, so they took the real axe, put it under glass, they made the glass a little dirty on purpose, and then they put the hologram on top of it here. So people should see, this was a hologram, this is a real object under glass. And people have problem to say which one is which. I'm sure a holographer will immediately know either you block the light, or another clue is, of course, that the real one has a shadow there from the light coming in at 45 degrees. When we made the hologram, we have a bigger plate, so we didn't make a hologram of the shadow. That's another difference here. But actually, the hologram looks better than the real thing. Now, I am not going through this because this will be covered by Alkis. So I think it's better he talks about. But I want to give one example of their work. He has been working with Yves Chantier, have recorded a hologram here. And you can see the beautiful of this ceramic vase that was produced in collaboration with Chantier. And then I also want to say something about computer-generated color holograms. And they are mainly stereograms where you use a camera going along a rail. And we will hear more about these things in other talks. But I want to mention this is the type of equipment you can use to record anything, input to a holographic digital hologram. This is a printer in Yola that prints this up to 1.2 by 2 meter big holograms. And we have examples here of artists using that. Another technique you can use is actually the scanner. You can scan an object, convert it into the 3D data, and produce a color hologram. So this Morris head was scanned and then sent to Yola to print the hologram. This hologram is like this big from the floor up. So when you have very big objects, of course, it's very difficult to work with the analog technique if you don't have very big plates. Of course, we will also hear from Zebra later, but one of their main activities, these beautiful maps that they can make in full color is something remarkable. They actually put them on the table, and for military application, they can walk around and look at them. So you will hear more about that in their presentation. Now we talk about artists and color holography. That is something that I think artists are probably more interested in, creative artists, than just to reproduce something with ultra-realistic reproduction of an artifact. But they are more interested, I think, in the 3D computer graphics design and maybe using the holoshot equipment. And as you have seen in the exhibition yesterday, Martin Richardson and others have taken advantage of that. as well as scientific application, of course, as we talk about the mummy head by Khan in Scotland. So this is also something brand new that has happened, that we can get them done in full color. By the way, analog holograms of full color has not really been many doing. Anait Stevens made one pseudoscopic sculpture of the American flag where the stars are falling off. And she made this, and this was around 1995. We did it at Lake Forest. And more recent huge hologram like Paula Dawson is famous for is, of course, very big holograms printed with Yola, and this is one of the more famous recent ones. And Martin Richardson, psychedelic AMI, you can see how beautiful it is now when you can add, if you like, real color or real color, but also add artistic features to it, like these glowing eyes that moves when you look at it. And then my summary here is, if you talk about analog holography, there is absolutely nothing in the world that can reproduce something like in a Dennis Hook hologram in full color, because we actually we freeze the light coming from the object, store the light and replay it forever without having the object. That is the ultimate goal of imaging. You can do it with acoustic waves. You can take music, store it and replay it forever without having an orchestra behind you. Now, light is much more difficult, but holography is the only technique known to human so that could actually store light and replay light. That's what holography, and also Gabor called it wavefront reconstruction, which is actually, so it's not really an image we make. We store and reconstruct light. And then the extensive field, of course, when you have 180, is making it even more realistic. Then I just mentioned that all this is covered in a book. You have a flyer that David Ratcliffe and I have been, it should be out later. It covers everything, including Lippmann photography. Then I would just thank you for your attention. This portrait was by Stas in Yola with his mobile phone. So he recorded me when you hold it and turn like that. And then he make these type of portraits. That's another thing that is extremely easy to make. You don't even need any equipment. It's just a mobile phone camera. Okay, thank you. Any questions?
Yes, one question. How much of a restriction is the fact that
you want to do another
one? Sorry. How much of a restriction is the fact that in the Dennis Hook hologram you've just got a single direction of illumination?
I can see there are problems when you want to have complex objects, but there is possible to add extra light to it. We have done it when we did Dennis Hook for the museum. We had mirrors that could guide light back from different directions. As long as it doesn't hit the plate, light can come in from sides and illuminate it. So it is possible to add extra light.